has been a fun 1990 season with the Red Raiders. You know, sometimes it seems like just a couple of weeks ago that we started at Columbus, Ohio. And then other times it seems like a thousand years ago that the Raiders started in Columbus as they finished with a 4-7 record on the 1990 season. However, it has been fun, and we've seen a lot of unusual things. We're going to show you a lot of that tonight in the video season ticket. We have the blooper bowl for you. All the crazy plays. We have Jack Dale, and we'll talk with Spike Dykes in depth. All of that on the video season ticket finale.
Well, we got off to a bad start. We went to Ohio State. Our kicking game broke down. We really played a great, great defensive football game. We played a pretty good offensive football game, and we had breakdowns in the kicking game, and we lost the game. Back Thursday night, played Houston, got in a scoring match with them, up and down, up and down, up and down, and once we don't get it in, they do, and then in a minute they get another one in, we don't, and they're two ahead of us, and our guys fought hard, hung in there. This was 4 days after playing Ohio State, and I thought they gave a great account of themselves. I really do. One of the better games we played, really, and that sounds ridiculous saying it, but it really was.
Thank you.
Coach came back the next week, went to play in Albuquerque against New Mexico, and New Mexico's got a team we always have a hard time with. We had a hard time with them. We won the game, but sort of left with a bad taste in our mouth. We had a lead. We let it get away from us. Then we got behind. We had to come from behind to win the game, and it was a great victory, but I think it, just because of the fact that we felt like we'd win that football game by a larger margin, it probably was a momentum breaker instead of a momentum gainer. Came back, played Baylor. Baylor had had a devastating week. They lost to Kent. They'd had just a very, very unsettling week. They started out and played horrible. And we played pretty good. We just couldn't quite get the ball in the end zone. And anyway, as the game went on, Baylor came out and got ahead of us, and we never could get the lead back. We felt like that's one that we let get away from us. Certainly not to say that Baylor didn't have a good team or didn't deserve to win the game, but we certainly could have won that ball game. College Station the next week, played A&M, and a cliffhanger right down to the wire. We lost the game in the fourth quarter. We had a chance to score a touchdown. We came up a few inches short on a touchdown pass, and well, now we're head really down, and this team all of a sudden is 1-4. going to Fayetteville, Arkansas, play University of Arkansas. He's picked to win the conference. And, of course, they're not very good. We just didn't know it at the time. And we beat a good Arkansas football team. But, again, the manner in which we did it, we had a big lead, 49-24, something like that, at the half, or early in the third quarter. And fooled around and let them back in the ballgame. Won the game 49-45. And, again, rather than being ecstatic about the victory, we sort of had our head down a little bit. Came back the next week and played a good Rice football team who had played well and who had just came within a field goal of beating the University of Houston. Went to Rice, played the worst game we played all year. I think as a coach I did a poor job of getting them ready to play, and we responded about the way that I said. We just didn't respond very well. We lost that football game. Came back home to play the University of Miami, and I think that's a humbling experience. It's one of those experiences that we certainly expected to play good. We expected to play hard. We were really never in the game. Miami came out, played a very deliberate game. They made no mistakes. They were very methodical in what they did, and they just dominated the football game. course, the University of Texas came in here, and we played the heck out of them. We really did. We had a chance to win that game as late as the fourth quarter. And don't get me wrong, I haven't said we should have won it, but we had a chance to. TCU played the best game we played all year against a good TCU football team. Finish it out with a nice win over SMU. We'll be right back. I guess the bad news is the fact that we lost 7 games. The good news is the fact that we could have won 7, but as Eagles we lost 7. And, you know, we would like to have done that because we felt like if we could really follow up last year's 9-3 season with another exciting winning season, that we would be where we need to be. And hopefully this did not deter the fact that we want to try to get to the Cotton Bowl. And, you know, what we've got to do now, we've got to do like a lot of things do. We just got to get it in gear. We've got to have a great spring. We've got to come back next fall and be ready to go. We have great Memphis. It's exciting. The thing that we have going for us, we've got 17 starters back from the football team that on a given day last year could have beaten anybody.
Almost any head coach will tell you the success of his football program depends on his staff of assistant coaches. We had the good fortune to get to know that Texas Tech staff this year, and Jeff DeFord has the profile of those men.
We'll kick off the rundown on all of Spike's men with Coach Carlos Maynard. Carlos has 2 titles, assistant head coach and defensive coordinator. He is personally responsible for overseeing the defensive secondary. Unbelievably, this is Carlos's 3rd stint coaching here at Texas Tech. Carlos is responsible for recruiting in Lubbock, parts of Dallas, and areas of New Mexico. Coach Dick Winder is another coach with 2 titles. He is the offensive coordinator and quarterback's coach. He is called the brain trust of Tech's offense. Coach Winder has been with Tech for 7 seasons. He is responsible for recruiting in the North Central Texas region as well as Fort Worth and the Mid-Cities. Rick Dykes, according to his father, has an excellent bloodline. You see, Rick is the running back's coach and Spike's son. Rick joined the Red Raiders staff in February. As running back's coach, he is responsible for recruiting in the North Houston area and areas south of Dallas. Defensive backs coach Gary Gaines knows what it feels like to win. As a high school head coach before coming to Tech, he amassed a record of 94 wins, 32 losses, and 5 ties. He also knows West Texas. That is his recruiting area, the entire West Texas region. Rudy Maskew is Tech's defensive ends coach. Rudy is a 75 graduate of Tech and is in his 6th year coaching here. Rudy's other job is organizing and maintaining all of the department's video equipment for those all-important after-game review and coaching sessions. Rudy's recruiting territory consists of the Central Texas regions like Waco and Killeen. Dean Slayton, the Sarge as they call him, is Tech's defensive tackles coach. He's earned a reputation coaching at Tech as being tough but fair. Dean has been with Tech ever since 1981 and is responsible for recruiting in East Texas and also Richardson, Plano, Garland, and Mesquite. The big German, Ted Unbehagen, is Tech's offensive line coach. His job was cut out for him this year with such a young crew. 7 seniors were gone after the 89 season. At Tech, he coached under Jim Carlin's staff from 1971 to 1974, then on to Rice and A&M, and back to Tech in 1986. Ted recruits the South Houston area and the coastal regions of Texas. Receivers coach Ivy Williams is on his 2nd year with the Tech staff. Ivy has coached in the NFL under Daryl Rogers with the Detroit Lions. All in all, he has 18 years experience and pass receiving expertise. Ivy recruits in Houston and Southeast Texas. John Paul Young heads up the linebackers for Tech. With 28 years experience coaching both college and professional football, Coach Young brings forth the best in his players. He came to Tech in 1989 after 10 years coaching in the NFL. John Paul recruits the Hill Country in Central Texas. That's it for all of Spike's men. With all that experience, it seems that Spike has assembled quite a crew. Just ask him and he'll tell you. For the Video Season Ticket, I'm Jeff DeFord.
On any highlight show, everything has to be perfect. Every spectacular play recorded. Well, not this time. We have what we have titled the Blooper Bowl, and we're going to show you most of the bad plays, put them to little sound effects, and show you the Blooper Bowl.
Yeah. Yes.
See, well, these Tech boys couldn't even get it right.
Lewis Sheffield fumbles the ball in the end zone.